philosophy is the weather. Oh, how you've been. You reach for my hand, all I do is draw circles in the sand.
I know. like.
And yes, here we are, Espresso Session, episode 127 in the studio. Aish and Varros, up and coming, songwriter, singer-songwriter. They're gonna play a show together, that's why they are together here. Let's play some music, it's a little dry right here. All right, welcome guys.
Thank Hi. You.
All right.
Hi, Nino.
Hi. So we just listened to two of your singles out. Aish was Orcas out of the album Mother, that was just released at end of March this year. And we also listened to the single Art of Mine by Varros.
Yeah.
It was released like
May, it's like May 19th.
May 19th.
Yeah.
So you guys are like in the, like songwriters with original part in your like music,
mm-hmm.
Especially I mean with the your song Varros was more like classic with Fender Rhodes and Vogels, mm-hmm. in the music of Aish. We listened to some beats with a quartet, string quartet, so it's a mix of like some writing with electronic music and chamber music together, no?
Yeah.
So let's start with this. So Mother, your album, Aish,
mm-hmm.
Features this, putting together some elements that can be a little discrepant at the first time, no? Like a live, it's a magic orchestra, no?
Yeah.
So, Mina Choi, if I'm spelling it right.
Yeah, Mina is incredible. She directs Magic. So what I do is I compose, I send it off to Magic. The incredible players come into the studio, they play the arrangements, and then that's how it goes. And for live as well, I work with Magic, and they're just incredibly talented people.
Okay, all right. Yeah, there was some noise coming out. Okay, no more. Figure it out. So you combine so the live, also your live performances with
chamber and electronics.
Chamber and electronics.
Yeah.
I saw some video out of YouTube, your channel.
Mm-hmm.
So you guys also you have also was it like a drummer with a drum kit, like
yeah.
an electronic drum kit.
Yeah. Well, it depends on the space.
Depends
you know?
On the space.
Yeah,
okay.
If it's a smaller space, then we'll just do electronic percussion with samples like my voice and like. Different percussive samples all together, like found sounds, etc., just out of the Roland. But if it's a larger space, then he'll bring like the vibraphone, the metallophones, and like an acoustic, parts of an acoustic kit, plus electronics. And then, but every show is going to have live chamber music. And the first record is a lot of strings, so you're going to have a trio at least. But then, depending on the space, if it's a large space, then we get a quartet and a choir and the whole thing.
Yeah, it seems like you have you are focused on your vision. You are like a pretty solid vision in your art, in your music, and you are like following it, no, like giving it life, no. So, even in the singles, the video that you put out, there is like this character, this kind of like a genderless black unicorn Pegasus. There is twice, no. So there is a story about it.
Yeah. So that was a fun story. So. I've got three videos out with Mother, and each of the videos has this like genderless human-like humanoid character set of characters, and Migrant and Orcas is basically a two-part of a single art project that I collaborated with Rashad Newsom. He's an incredible artist out of New York, and he does Vogue, like underground Vogue dance in like New York. He's big there. And he does collage art, and he's got these incredibly massive collages, like the size of, gosh. So World Trade Center currently is displaying his collages across like the end-to-end of the top floor, I think. And so he does these like massive collages. And when we met, we were like, so I want to get something bizarre, but also wonderful. And it was also a time where immigration, the record is also a lot about migration. And so we wanted to bake in that idea of migrating from a land that you call home to a new place where you can create a new home in. And so he came up with the idea of, how about some black unicorns? And that was so bizarre. I was like, yep, that's it. We're going to do that. And so I show up at the studio and he's like, you know what? We're going to do a two-part thing. We're going to do one for orcas, one for migrant. We're going to make this whole narrative around it. And then I show up and they're like six dancers there with all unicorn horns, like jumping around in the green room in the studio. It was a lot of fun to watch. And then he put this horn on me and we were shooting for like 6 hours straight up. And they literally glued the horn on my forehead. And because it didn't stick. But so the makeup artist, who's this incredible trans woman, she had this like really strong glue. And so she used that glue, which you would use for hair. And she put it on my forehead and like stuck the horn in my head. So it stuck well. But at the end of it, my head was like a whole giant red bruise. But it was a good video in the end. So it was fun.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, what do you got to do for art, no?
No pain, no gain.
Yeah,
no.
Exactly, exactly. But also, you know, like in your visual, like in your picture, you always are like kind of like very glamorous and very like colorful. Like you had like a Mondrian outfit. And so you play with it, like along with it. And so looks like you kind of like put like your persona, like your public persona out there, no? Clearly, no?
Yeah, and I mean, if you're going to make art, let's just make it all the way.
All
let's
the
not
way.
Do like a half-assed thing. Yeah. Like just a mild little thing. Here's a little piece of work for you guys.
Yeah.
It's like, put it out there and make it bold and make it like memorable, you know?
Yeah, because also you, like in your song, in your music, talk about like the migration because you are a migrant from India.
Yeah, so yes. I migrated from India and... coming to the US was an incredible experience. I felt accepted and also foreign all at once. Being gay, you know, in India is still a crime. And coming to the United States gave me a lot of acceptance. I found people who were really accepting, but there was also this very strong awareness of, you know, xenophobia or the other, the idea of the other that exists, and particularly like since 2016, it's been just really in our consciousness and awareness. But generally, America has been very accepting, and in fact, it's a great place to make art. There's a great value attached to making art in the States. Yeah.
And in your album Mother, mostly, I mean, it's dedicated to your mom, to your the story like a separation and acceptance and be accept after separation, no? Because it's like tumultuous. You put your childhood first, no, in your songwriting. So you make it personal and you kind of demonize through singing that, no? So you like...
Yeah, it's almost like you have to work your... Okay, so this is a brand new project for me in that I was challenging myself to write with an entirely new palette of instrumentation, with an entirely new way of composition. So I'm a composer, and I write all the strings and the arrangements for beats, etc. And so this was a brand new challenge for me. And at a meta level, where I wanted to start was, what would a child do coming alive, you know, coming out of the womb of, you know, what I wanted to create? So this record was as much about my relationship with my mother as much as it was about me being a mother to my new music. And there are lots of parallels there. For example, you know, my mother, I sort of have three mothers. There's the biological mother, then there's the adoptive mother, then there's the spiritual mother. But even physically, almost, there are like three big female, feminine influences in my life. I've got two sisters and a mother. And they all have been mother figures for me because of this massive age difference between us. And so I wanted to work out what my relationship to these mothers meant and how it affected even basic elemental things like feelings like joy and sorrow, which all of us experience. And what we don't realize is these basic elemental feelings like joy and sorrow are essentially shaped by the first attachments we experience with our mothers. Most of us are mothers, and that's really where it comes from. And that's what I wanted to write about the fear of the abandonment, the attachment, the association, the love, and the separation. Because we all individuate. We don't just live with our mothers all our lives. We separate at some point, become our own individuals. So this record is a lot about working that out too.
And in musical wise, like in the let's say like the sonic palette, like you. So you say like you compose the strings, so you want the strings, like the chamber part, predominant in your music.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
So let's talk about this element, no? Because at the first listen, it's not like the string section is not playing like patterns or loop. It's like saying its own phrase, no?
Yeah.
So makes the music itself more like intricate, complex, and but like not easy, no, at the first listen.
Yeah.
No?
I mean, it's incredible that you're able to hear that and call that out. Not many people are able to just listen to music for the joy of it, but you're able to actually hear that strings aren't just like a background pad almost. They're actually have their own melody lines, their own lead lines. And the reason why I wrote it that way is because, A, while I'm a writer and a singer, I'm also a composer. And I want, anytime if I'm going to write a lead melody, whether it's on strings or voice, I treat them very similarly. They're both instruments.
Yeah.
And so I'm going to write a melody for both of them. The other piece is I wanted to bring like this notion of high art and classical art that's sort of been trapped in the ivory walls of the symphony halls and bring it to pop music. And so that's why I created the palette that I did. And I wanted the strings to be very present right along with the voice because, like you said, you know, I didn't want it to be a supporting element. I wanted it to be an element that demonstrates that this is pop music with composition. For the real, like for your listeners who are really, really into music, they would recognize that. So it's not just for the pop audience. It's for people who appreciate music and composition.
Yeah, and definitely, you gotta, yeah, exactly like you explained, no? Because you have to go and focus on the, so you have more layers of appreciation in your music, no? Like the singing part, like the lyrics and the melodies, not just the melody, because, you know, you have to, it's like every listen, you like unveil, like, and you get to know better. Like,
there are layers. Yeah. There's a lot to unpack. And you can listen to this record 10 times, you'll find something new in there. And it's also not just the way I wrote it, it was also how Bo and I, my producer, Incredible.
Yeah, Bo Sorensen. Yeah.
Yes, Bo Sorensen. How we produced this record is we packed in sort of these like little secrets and little hideaways in these corners that if you listen to it over and over again, you'll always discover something new. So that's really exciting about this record. Yeah,
yeah, there are 11 songs or 10 songs.
There are 11 songs.
11 yeah. songs. And yeah, let's give credit to co-producer Bo Sorensen.
No? Yes.
And he works for Tiny Telephone and many others, like worked with too many to mention, like the artists yeah. he's been working too. He also worked with you, no?
Yeah.
Like, so Andrew Varros. And he also as a performer in the record, no? Performed some
some of the beat samples, he played the beat samples, some of the synths he actually composed out of these like really, so he introduced me to a bunch of really eclectic and esoteric synths as well. For example, the Buchla, I never worked with the Buchla, and what I really appreciate about the Buchla is it was built with the idea that it's gonna do away with like your 12, 13 note, you know, tone, semitone, like Western scale.
Yeah.
And you could create your own scale. You could create a scale of 24 notes if you wanted to. You can have all those inner tones and create your scale out of just, you know, with just two notes if you wanted to. And it doesn't have to stick to like an A, B, C, D model. You can basically create your own palette with it. And that was really exciting. So we could bend and play and morph the sound. We could reshape the sound with the Buchla. And so he introduced me to the Buchla, and he, so that's an example of some of the fun we had.
Yeah, also, you know, Buchla was operating here of Berkeley. So it's like a local.
It is so funny you mentioned that because he was at, the original, I believe the first Buchla ever made still sits in Mills College. In Oakland, and we have to, this is sort of the legacy and the heritage of the Bay Area we sometimes forget, because, you know, it's now like a one business town of technology, but there's a lot of music, a lot of experimentation that came out of the Bay Area. Like Laurie Anderson, she went to, you know, Mills, and she's incredible. Like, she's an inspiration.
Yeah, we try on this show, we try to focus on the local talents and the local beauty that is still in the Bay Area besides the gentrification and the Now San Francisco is worldwide known for technology, yeah. But still, you know, the artistic and the progressive side of San Francisco is still like strong, no?
Yeah.
That actually, you mentioned before, like the scale and the 12 semitones, like where the Western music is mostly like all about. But you are from India, and there are even like the semitones are different, no? Like, yeah. So there are way more than 12. So the question is, your musical education was mostly like Western music, or also with Indian, Indian heritage?
It was both. It was both. I mean, music to me was, it just came naturally as a language. But growing up in the family that I grew up, the arts were sort of a privilege, you know. Like my parents, for all the good intentions, wanted me to grow up to be able to be sustainable, able to be fend for myself, provide for myself. So arts really wasn't seen as a viable way of being able to support oneself, and so it was seen as a luxury. And art was always there, but it was something that I had to really go and reach out and clasp and like reach out to. So when I first started learning music, it was Hindustani classical, which is the North Indian Eastern school of music, and there are like different schools within the Hindustani style. But there are lots of like inner microtones happening all day long. They have these like, in Hindustani classical music, there's something called alap, which basically is holding this one note and like for, I'd say minutes on end, like really, really long notes, and then carrying ever so gently these micro tones up to the next note. So that on the one end, and the other end, I studied Western classical music, composing with your like standard Western scales and 4/4, 3/4 time, the kind of time signatures that are most common in a lot of the pieces written. So that gave me a really good palette of what the West and East meant. And so when I sing now, you see a lot of slides and microtones happening. That's probably coming from my childhood. And then from my adulthood and like learning is where all this composition, which is quite Western grounded, is coming from.
And you had a classical education, or like a musically speaking?
Yes.
Okay.
I studied composition and voice in college. Okay. Yeah.
And you came to California. Actually, you covered the Joni Mitchell song California.
Yes.
And you stated, like, in I was reading on your Bandcamp that was like you mentioned right before. So you felt accepted and you found a new home, like Joni Mitchell, Canadian,
yeah.
Moved to California and found a home. No.
Yeah.
So this probably can be. I would like to play actually that song.
Yes.
And but before, like, while I look for it, you introduce it. So that can be an example, no? Like of you coming out from India and find a new home, bringing your own experience and background to this land, no? That was accepting and where you can express yourself and be yourself, no? And make art.
Yeah.
Totally.
I mean, California, and you talk about Joni Mitchell, and gets me so excited because at the time, like Joni Mitchell was doing this, what, in the 60s or 70s? And it's a female folk song singer-songwriter, and their expectations of women in music even today and back when she made and released California, there's so many more expectations. And there's this, I think, New York Times piece, or the New Yorker piece, where they talked about how people expected Joni Mitchell to be this, you know, songstress, like pretty songstress, and she just defied all expectations and she just did her own thing. And that's what really inspires me about Joni Mitchell, that she, and I mean, I would say something controversial, while Leonard Cohen gets a Nobel Prize, I think Joni Mitchell has written much more prolifically, and her writing is just really inspiring, incredible. And for being a woman at that time in the industry and making it so far and just experimenting and pushing limits, because like her future records were also so weird and like went all over the place. There's, yeah. There's jazz happening, there are these big chamber orchestras playing on her records, so it's all very inspiring.
And definitely it's not like I mean the album Blue, no, it's, yeah, not like classic even songwriting, like the structure of songs is it's like avant-garde.
It's very avant-garde.
For that time.
So, like, if you're going to play California, my arrangement for California is very different from her original arrangement of California, which, by the way, actually, if you go on JoniMitchell.com, you see my version of California on her website.
Oh, okay, cool.
Yeah, it's kind of cool to see that she was actually listening or somebody's watching out there. But when I was actually rearranging California to record as my cover, like, in rap music, you talk about flow. Like, she was... she was crazy flowing in that song. She's packed in all these words and like these little vowels and syllables in there, and she's flowing in that song. Like, if you really listen to it, she's like really almost rapping in a way with a lot of melody. That's quite inspiring to see.
Yeah, definitely
that.
The metric of the song is not easy to like you said, like, you should fit the song in the lyrics, in the structure, in the song structure. Let's play the song California, Joni Mitchell cover by Aish.
Looks bad, they won't give peace a chance. That was just a dream summer first had. Still a lot of lands to see, but I wouldn't wanna stay here. It's too old and cold and settling, it's lazy. But California, California, I'm coming home. I'm gonna see the folks I dig. I'll even kiss the sunset peak. California, I'm coming home. I met a redneck on a Grecian island, hooded the curtains very well. He gave me back my smile, but he kept my camera to sell. Oh, the rogue, the red, red rogue. He cooked omelets and stews, and I might have stayed on the but my heart cried out for you. California, California, I'm coming home. Make me feel good, rock and roll band. I'm your biggest fan. California, I'm coming home. Strangers, old news at home. Just give you the blues. So I bought me a ticket. I got a plane to Spain. Went to a party on a red dirt road with lots of pretty people that read in Rolling Stone, read in Vogue. They said, how long can you hang around? Is it just in time, my skin turns brown, and I'm going home to California, California, I'm coming home. Will you take me as I am, strung out on another man? California, I'm coming home. Full of strangers, all the news at home read. Oh, by the war and the bloody changes. Will it take me as I am? Will you take me as I am? Will you? Will you take me as I am? Will you take me as I am?
So much fun to make that song.
Yes, like we were talking before, no? Like, so destructuralizing, like, conventional, even rhythm and melodies, no? And play with, the string, even if a quartet, like a string section, You can hear like pizzicato, like the bow play part. So, you know, like it's complex arrangement and completely like refresh, you know, like I think this song is from 1969, 67. So from late 60s, no?
Yeah.
And it's completely like completely like rework, no? And give like another like suspended feeling, no? That is.
Thank you. Yeah.
Cool.
It was a lot of fun making this song, and I mean all the background vocals you hear, like these chopped up vocals. Working this with strings was another interesting thing, because her like lead guitar line, which she plays in dulcimer, the song live for the BBC, was gorgeous, and I wanted to turn that into like a pizzicato, as you said. So it was a lot of fun making the song, and just like redoing the flow. And you said something about being avant-garde, and Joni Mitchell did an incredible job doing, you know, creating this the right combination of avant-garde and pop, and that's really what I want to do with my work. Is I mean, I could be, you know, sitting out on the top of a mountain hitting a giant tambourine with, you know, and a marimba on the side, and that'll be experimental music. That could be. That's still musical. But I want to make something that's still avant-garde, still fresh, but also poppy, that you can listen to in a relaxed way, almost. And another person who's a great inspiration and does that really, really well is Bjork. Like, she pulls in the avant-garde as can be, and then produces in this beautiful pop format that people get, and so that's really what I'm after. That's what I'm doing.
So, like, so Bjork is a big influence in your.
She's a spiritual mother to me. Yeah. Like, she's been such. She's like, again, another female artist in the, you know, starting 80s, 90s, and with the Sugar Cubes. She paved the path for the pop avant-garde, for art pop. You know, David Bowie was doing that, David Byrne's been doing that, but these are also men who could take a lot of liberties at that time. But Bjork, she definitely paved the path for a lot of us, and she's an inspiration for a lot of us, and she's still relevant, and she's still putting out great material, and she's also a very visual artist. And she, again, her ethos is also, if she's going to put art out, it's going to be bold, it's going to be really memorable, and it's going to be shocking, and you're going to remember it. And that really inspires me about Bjork.
Yeah, like you said, you mentioned shocking, and you're gonna remember, no? Because you play with this element also, no? In your communication in general, no? Like, you try to be shocking, no? Like, even like in your pictures, you always try to be like, you know, not just you try to give a memorable experience to your listener, to your, yeah, you know, to your fan, you know?
Yeah.
And what I see that like from your music, from your art, you have like a clear vision where you want to go and where you are going. So it's a nice spot.
Thank you.
Good. Let's play another song from the album Mother. Let's play I think it's called Blackbird.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Love that song.
You want to introduce that song real quick while I...
Okay, so Blackbird is... It's a beautiful song, but it's really about... it's about a couple of things. Gosh, one is about a sadness and a certain depression that... You know, we all feel sad at times. And it's, again, something that we learn and become aware and try to understand from people who are closest to us, and try to understand, what is this feeling that I'm experiencing? And... I learned what sadness meant and how to deal with it from my mother, because she also experienced her sadness, and we almost exchanged notes, not literally, but we had our own ways to relate to sadness and depression. Then the other reason I wrote the song is because, you know, when we talk about mothers in pop culture, it's like Mother's Day, and mothers and children, this is a great, beautiful relationship, go send a bouquet or some, you know, and a Hallmark card. That's so reductive. There is something real in post post birth depression. It's a real thing. So that song also talks about how mothers deal with that, and again it's about how we relate to sadness, but it's done in a really beautiful way. And that's also another aspect of my work, is while it might be a serious topic, it's just done in such a beautiful way that you can appreciate the poeticism behind it. So That's Blackbird.
Cool. And let's listen to Blackbird from Mother, Ash. Blackbird, yes. With like housey bass vibe, dancey with like the string complexity.
Yeah,
it's nice. And and the lyrics also,
there's a lot of
lots of elements, yeah, but put together like in a beautiful way, you know, like it's a great work behind the decks from Bo, but also, you know, writing it, so on your side.
Thank you. Yeah, it was a great juxtaposition. I actually brought, I don't know if you want to talk about it now, but I brought a visual which really inspired a lot of the songs in the record too. We can talk about it later.
No, we can talk about it now also, yeah.
Yeah. So let me actually...
Let's get the painting. A Picasso.
Yes, it is a Picasso. So
it's not an original, otherwise we won't be here doing this.
I know.
Yeah, sure.
I know. Okay.
I'll just put this glass right here.
Okay. So let's see. Let me see if your listeners and viewers can see this.
Put it on frame. Yes.
This work is called La Tragedia, and this was
the tragedy.
Yeah, the tragedy, and this work was made actually. There's a reflection on it. Okay. So this work was made by Picasso during his blue period when he was actually quite depressed, because I think he'd gone to Paris to like become this great big artist, and like it really hadn't worked out. And then I think one of his really close friends had passed away, so he escaped off to Spain again. And I think the blue period happened during the time he spent on the Malaga coast, and this is one of the pieces from the blue period. And what I love about this for folks who can see, or folks listening, I'll describe it. There is, like, it's a scene on a beach, and it's all in like different shades of blue. It's just like monotone blue, and there is a male figure, sort of bearded male figure, looking down on the sand, barefoot. Then there is a child next to that male figure, not looking down, sort of looking at this other person is across, which is a woman, presumably the mother, who's also looking down on the sand, and they're all barefoot, and both the man and the woman have this like sort of a sad reflective expression on their face, but the child is sort of still curious and almost like wondering what's about to happen or what's happening with around him. And this is sort of the blueness of this was what this record is what's representing through the record for me. And it's also this, what must be going on for the child here is what's representing in the record for me, is how this child is relating, trying to understand, work out what's happening with his mother and the relationship with his family, what it means to be an individual himself almost. So this was quite inspirational. And this painting literally hangs above the organ I write a lot of the music on. And I see it all the time when I'm composing. Yeah. So that's Picasso La Tragedia. It's a beautiful piece.
The tragedy.
Yeah.
So let's talk actually about your composition project. Okay. Process, sorry. So how do you usually... You start with an idea of like a topic you want to cover, or like a memory, or like an emotion, and that is the ignition, or like you have a melody in your head, or you. So how do you?
You know, it works. It works in all sorts of different ways. Most typically, the melody and the concept comes together, and it almost like comes together in that the melody, concept, and the phrasing almost comes together. So it's like when you're a child, you sort of are doing your thing, you're playing with toys, or you're just basically expressing general human freedom, but you're also like maybe singing a little phrase, and you just make up phrases. That's really how music comes to me. It just comes as a phrase, which comes with a melody and also a concept behind it, which it all starts from that phrase. And then I develop that phrase into what the melodic information there is in that phrase, and then also the concept I start developing into writing. And usually, if I have to go beyond 8 drafts of edits on a given song, I know it's not going to go anywhere. It's going to be like a still-born song. But if it's lesser than that, if it comes fairly quickly, that's when I know the song is looking to... Because these songs are individuals on their own. These are living beings. Like, for me, these are living things and these are individuals, and they're almost speaking to me that they want to come out as children, like, you know, it's yeah. as if I have a womb and they want to come out of my belly to emerge as individuals. And I just have, my job is to give them a voice and raise them well, and then they're off into the world for people to listen and be with. Yeah. So yeah, it's a very, it starts with a phrase and then starts to develop. And I know after, if after eight to 10 edits, I don't have the song, it's probably over labored. It's not going to come together. So most of my work is, doesn't feel too labored, because it just comes from, you know, just a 8 to 10 drafts.
Or probably, you know, those songs that they have, more than 8 or 10 drafts, they can sit for a second, and then like probably like some year after you can like rediscover them, no, you know, or maybe you're gonna go through other.
Yeah. You're so right. That happens all the time, where I'd rediscover a song, and what happens is I left it in such an overlabored form, like one of those songs that I don't make it to the record or don't make it to the studio, that I overlabored. Those songs I pick up maybe after 3 years, and I still love the concept, still love the melody, so I have to like deconstruct it again and build it again, and then it becomes a song. So yes, it happens all the time. But yeah, after, once you develop the phrase, it takes like 3 different parts. It takes a path of the actual writing. And I do think the actual writing is sort of the foundation of the house. If, you know, if your music, if your song was like a great big sculpture building, the foundation is the writing. If the writing's not good, however much production you're going to paste over it, however much like beautiful composition you're going to slap over it, it's not going to be a good song. If the writing's not there,
yeah.
It's almost like the underwear. Like if you have to feel comfortable in your clothes underneath.
Let's say the bones, no, like yeah. the skeleton, no, of a song. The writing should start with a good writing, or yeah. like yeah, even like when you when you record, like the recording should be good, and you can do the editing in post, no, but you know,
yeah.
So let's your record. So this 11. Individuals that you brought to the world, no?
Yeah.
So you are pretty happy about it.
I am really happy.
Really happy about it. And you're gonna start a little tour now, bringing these songs, this composition,
yeah.
sharing with public, no? It's something that is gonna start at the end of this month. You guys have actually a show together.
Yes.
On Saturday.
The 28th.
The 28th. Yeah. Yeah. July 28th, it's right here at the Lost Chapel.
Yeah, the Lost Church.
The Lost Church.
It's an incredible venue. Like, I had not heard of the Lost Church, but when I read more about it and I saw the pictures, this gorgeous art venue, which is sort of hidden away, but some incredible musicians, incredible acts, you know, visiting town or local acts have played there. And I was so surprised by the kind of roster that had played at that venue. And then I looked deeper into that venue encourages no amplification, as little of electronic instruments as possible. And that seemed to work really nicely with at least my ensemble, where it's a string trio and it's going to have like an acoustic drum set. So it was a perfect venue, and it's such a beautiful space. And the people who run the venue are great. That's another thing. I want to perform in venues. I want to work with people who are nice.
Yeah.
The industry is full of people.
I know, yeah.
You know, who would, as a new artist, would make you question your work, your worth. And it's one of the most important things for an artist to, like, really believe in what they are about, who they are, and work with people who are nice, you know? Like, there are lots of people, there are lots of choices. This industry is full of incredible, talented people. Let's work with people who are kind and nice and who get your vision. So anyway, the Lost Church, back to the Lost Church, incredible studio, great people who run the bookings there, and it's great. And can't wait to see you there. Hopefully you can make it.
Yes. Yeah, yeah. I will. So you guys gonna, so you say you're gonna have like a trio, string trio, and the drummer
yep.
performing with you. And what about you, Varros? You're gonna do?
Yeah, I'm planning to have, so I started working with my bandmate, Sierra McAllister, and she's an amazing pianist, songwriter, singer, and artist as well. And she and I are going to do an acoustic set together. So we're probably going to bring the Nord and jam it out and
ooh.
Yeah, keep okay. it. Like, I love that too. Like, that's something that when Ash asked me to play with him, I was really excited about the venue. only because it looks so beautiful and everyone's been incredible so far. And but how I started, like, when I came to the city, is I would just play open mics, and I would just play like at the Utah and play on like the upright piano they have there. I'd bring my keyboard to Bazaar Cafe, and I feel like the intimacy of that, of keeping a set so acoustic and letting really the music be channeled through you and through your voice, is something that I find so connective, and I feel like I emote so well through that. And so I'm incredibly excited to be able to do that with Sierra and with Ash.
I'm excited to have to be playing. This is going to be the first show we've played together.
I know. I'm so excited.
I think your voice is beautiful, and I just can't wait to have it be, to be playing with you. Yeah.
Likewise. I'm so incredibly excited and so honored that I get to share this experience with you.
Yeah.
In your aesthetic, like music aesthetic, you are like more like stripped down, no? Like,
yeah.
Like we listen to in like the Art of Mine. So you play mostly on your vocals and like basic arrangement, like focusing more like on the intimacy of of the music, mostly because so your songwriting is talking about like personal experience, so, or it's like, I mean, I want you to explain me this, why this like stripped down aesthetic in your music.
Yeah, for me, my work, especially this project, this EP project called The X Days, I see it as my diary, and very similar to how Ash explained his process of writing, I feel each of these songs are like little beings that capture moments in my life and my experiences in love and relationships and coming to my sexuality through those things, and also like through my own self-love experiences. And I grew up playing violin in the orchestra. I played for 12 years, and I also grew up playing classical piano, and I taught myself how to play piano from this movie that Hilary Duff was in called Raise Your Voice. And Kat Dennings was playing a pianist in that movie, and she played The Tempest, a part of a sonata from Beethoven. I don't remember the number, but so beautiful. The piano is so complex and technical, but emotional also. And I kind of fell into the piano in a way. Like, it felt like it merged into me and was a part of me, and I found that I could escape a lot of the experiences that I was having at that time, and like questions of who I was and what does it mean to feel the things that I feel, like what is love, like all of these different things. And I felt that the piano allowed me to channel that and turn those feelings into something that was tangible and cleansing, almost. Like, when I play, it's very like spiritual for me. And I gradually started writing through that, and I guess that's just kind of the organic process and how I love to write. Like, I love being able to simplify things down to where all of the rawness and emotion comes through, like the expression of like dynamic and emotion through my voice and through like what the instruments are providing in their own voices, I think.
So starting as a violin player, you switch on the piano for attracted of the beauty of it, and also the more complexity, because you have like a rhythm instrument, it's a percussive instrument as well, but also melodic and harmonic, no?
Yeah.
So, and so you mentioned the X Days, so it's your EP you are working on, no?
Yeah, it's
that's where the single is from.
Yes, so the single Heart of Mine is part of the collective work that I consider the X Days, and I recently actually was just with Bo in May, and we finished up the whole EP project. And
yay.
So that's super exciting. It feels like a huge labor of love for sure. And yes, like you said, I feel like I gave birth. Each song,
it's
like,
as painful but as joyful at the same time.
It is. It so is. And yeah, it's incredible to have it done. So the whole project, The X Days, is releasing at the end of the summer, and yeah, it's very much like a diary to me and my experiences. So, Yeah, it's really exciting. It's crazy.
And you're gonna perform some of the songs in the EP on Saturday, the 28th.
No? Yes. Yeah. Okay.
And you have like a timeline for? So you said the EP is gonna be out at the end of summer, no? Are you gonna release another single?
Yeah, actually, the day of the show on the 28th, I'm releasing my second single, titled "Burn Me to the Ground," and it's kind of like my anthem for the whole project. It's like the last song that ends the whole storyline within that work, and it's kind of like encapsulates the moment in my life where I found self-value. Like growing up gay, especially, but growing up gay in the Midwest was, I'm sure, very similar to your experience.
You're not from India, but you're from Indiana.
Indiana, no? Yeah.
Same difference.
It's so funny, though, because when I tell people I'm from Indiana here, like, most of the time, they think I say India. And I'm like, Indiana, it's quite not as cool as India. But, growing up gay in such a conservative place like the Midwest, still to this day, I always have this dirtiness that sticks with me, and a lot of the experiences I've had in relationships and in love that are reflected in this journey in the EP are kind of me cleansing that dirtiness in a way, and also discovering like self-empowerment through these experiences. And so Burn Me to the Ground is very much like that, like, fuck you moment where you realize that, you know, you are powerful and you are able to take control of your life and what that means to yourself, you know.
And you also coming out in Indiana, you coming here to San Francisco, California, you found a home here, yeah. Nowhere to express yourself, be yourself, and don't deny, don't like hide yourself, and also put yourself out in your music, you know, in your lyrics.
Exactly.
So it was like a nice moment, no? Like,
yeah, very like similarly, again, with Ash and his experience migrating to the U.S. and how that became home, a new home for him. Very similarly to me as well. Indiana felt like home. It still is home in some ways, but San Francisco feels like my home. And moving here was like pivotal moment of my life, both musically and also personally and spiritually and so many other facets. But being in a city that's so free and so diverse and so encouraging of eccentricity and creativity and all of these different things allowed me to really discover who I am as a person, and I still am discovering that through the city today.
It is great to hear. You want me to play like the Burn Me to the Ground?
Yeah.
Yeah, as a preview?
Yeah, that'd be okay. Awesome.
Ooh, so is this like the first airing of your new single?
Yes.
That's amazing. That's a moment.
That is a moment. I'm so excited.
That's a moment. All right, so this is Varros, Burn Me to the Ground, unreleased here, espresso-pff.fm.
My heart right from the start. You thought I'd burn, that I'd burn to the ground with you. Boy, you played me down. Thought you could sell me out, that I would fall with you. You cursed me from the start, dragged me right to the dark and bound me in your haze. Since I've been free from you, I've done more than I do. I've bleached out all your stains. The darkness we once knew is all I had to lose. There's a hollowed beat that drums in my chest.
to the ground. Your love was take and take. Withdrawal was hard to shake. I would have always stayed. But our days have come and gone. But nowhere you've undone the reckoning price must be paid. Yeah, there's a hollowed beat that drums in my chest. I'm rising. There's a battle call that sounds in my head. I'm rising. I will love again. You won't burn me down.
And this was Burning to the Ground, like unreleased, like a sneak preview. I can definitely hear. So in your influence, you mentioned in your websites or somewhere I remember reading. So you have like this soul Motown influence. This kind of Amy Winehouse also.
Yeah.
And. Comparing to the song we heard before, like Heart of Mine, this is more like arranged with like a kind of like a with the whole band, no?
Yeah.
There is like a guitar, like bass, drums, piano.
Yeah, we had Jason Slota on drums, Mark Allen Piccolo played guitar, Nate Brenner from Tune Yards did all the bass stuff, and then there's like some piano stuff, and like on the whole album, Sierra McAllister has played some piano. Debbie Nayer also. I've done like a little bit of piano work, tons of like synth work underneath everything, and like random like little percussive elements in each song. And yeah, it's pretty much growing up, I listened to my family, especially my dad, loved listening to 60s, 70s music and Motown and soul, like Janis Joplin, Etta James, Otis Redding, and contemporarily artists that have really influenced me are like Amy Winehouse or Sam Smith or Adele. And Motown, I've always loved like the expressiveness of it and like the fun energy behind it, and also like the intensity and power behind like the instrumentation as well as like vocal performance. So...
And as we can hear on Burn It to the Ground, no?
Yeah.
Cool. And so let's have a little let's talk about this EP, no? So how many songs are gonna be? And
It's gonna be a total of six songs.
Six songs, okay.
Yeah,
that you've been recording in like recently, like
Yeah, the whole process, we started like a year and a half ago, Bo and I, working on this project, and we did most of the tracking within the first month of starting, and then vocal arrangement and background vocal arrangement and mixing and editing and fine-tuning little elements like synth work and piano work throughout the rest of the year and a half. And then the majority of this past year up to May was mixing and finalizing all of the songs. So it's been a crazy journey, like my first journey recording any of my work and bringing that to life. And it's crazy how these songs start as little tiny ideas and me and the piano just having honest conversations between each other, and now seeing them,
they've developed.
Yeah, it's crazy.
Cool. So there are many things that like put you guys like, you know, on a common ground. No, also, I mean, besides being being gay, from like a very like
conservative
yeah. let's say like environment. But also, you guys been working together with Bo Sorensen. Also, yeah, they're like the same vocal coach.
Yeah,
Heather Pierce.
She is incredible.
She is.
You know, she's really helped, you know, live performance and just recording on the record. Heather's been just incredible. And if anybody's ever considering singing or feels like they can't sing, you know, Heather would make you understand and know that anybody can sing, and she can really coach you through. Just, you know, if you ever wanted to make music, go to Heather.
Yeah,
she's great.
Exactly.
Also, giving props to her for putting this together.
Yeah.
No? Because, you know, thanks to her, I met you guys also. No? So
Yeah.
Cool. And so on the 28th, let's spend a few more words about the event you guys are playing together. No? So you're going to release the single, Varros,
yes.
on the same day.
Yes,
no?
The same day as the show.
And Ash, what are you going to do for that? This is going to be the starting of your tour, no? You said you're going to go in the West Coast a couple of days.
Yes, I'm really excited and slightly anxious and nervous in a good way for this tour. So this is going to be, you know, sort of the bookend. So this is the beginning bookend of the tour. And it's going to be at the Lost Church, 7/28, Saturday. So everybody should come out at Saturday night, no excuses. And it's going to be songs from Mother. But also I'm going to test out and workshop and just play and see how listeners respond to, I think I might do 3 songs from the next record, which actually I'm about 70% done.
Oh, okay,
studio,
cool.
Yeah,
cool.
It's coming out next year in the spring.
Okay.
So I'll be playing a couple of songs from the new record. And then after the Lost Church in San Francisco, I head off to Seattle and then Portland and then LA, possibly make a pit stop at San Diego and then come back to San Francisco for the finale end show on 8/22 at Rickshaw.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
And you're gonna go with the trio, string trio, and drummer.
That's another exciting. You know, I think.
Or it's gonna be different according to them.
It's by city, so
yeah.
How it worked out, and it's gonna be exciting because I get to meet all these incredible like classical players. Because a lot of these players like play at San Jose Symphony, San Francisco Symphony. They're playing Nutcracker. Like they're coming from real classical backgrounds, and so it's incredible to meet these people who come from this classical world and have them play on pop compositions, and they love doing that, and I love having them because it
cool.
brings a whole different perspective.
Yeah.
So Helen Newby, who's an incredible cellist, who I met via Mina Choi of Magic Magic, and our first show was actually in December, and since then Helen has been sort of the staple cellist of my band. And then Taylor Rankin, who's the drummer and electronic percussion. So my rhythms are really weird. Like they have a lot of syncopation and they're built with like vocal samples, etc., and Taylor got it, and so he's got this like really special gems of knowledge about my music. So Helen, Taylor, and I will be traveling together across the entire coast, and then each local city we're going to get a violin and a violist for the
because the music vocals. You have already charted, so you can give charts.
It's all charted.
Okay, yeah.
And you know, like most of the folks who come from a classical background, then the sight reading chops are great. They know what kind of music it is, what kind of feel it's going to be, and I can just describe, you know, don't play too much tremolo, don't make it too fiddly, make it more straight and dark, like darker timbre. So when I describe that, they just immediately get it. So all our rehearsals with these new players are going to be just basically the sound check.
And yeah. So you mentioned before you already have like a new album that is 70% done, no?
Yeah.
So that means that once you start, like, you can't stop. I mean, if once you start making music, so if it's like an outlet that you found, like expressive outlet, it's good, and it's good for you, make you feel better, and you can't stop, no? Like, it's like the creativity flow that goes, no?
Yeah. I mean, I feel grateful every day because I hear all these stories about, you know, when you write your first record and then you get this great anxiety and get this block of what's going to happen next.
Yeah.
You don't know where you're going to go next. And I feel really grateful every day that creativity, this music, this being, the spirit that music is still flowing and talking through me, and I'm still putting work out. And so I'm just grateful, and I just don't envision stopping anytime soon.
That's great. Okay,
at all. Yeah. And, oh, the other thing is, which is going to happen between, so Mother, my debut, came out March 30th, and tentatively around spring is when the next record's going to come out. But in the middle, I'm going to release a collaborative mixtape. And I actually haven't shared this on air anytime yet.
Okay.
We haven't even shared this with the press yet, so another moment. We're going to release a mixtape, and it's these collaborations with incredible artists across the globe. Artists of color, queer artists, artists who are just really pushing the form, avant-garde form. So one example is my great friend, just incredible electronic artist, her name's Susie Analog. In fact, she was the opening act for the Sylvan Esso tour that happened, I believe, 2 months ago. So she's on the mixtape. Mess Kid, you know, he does music for the fashion. He comes from the fashion angle, so he does music for Alexander Wang. He's on the record. There are a whole bunch, and there's this incredible artist out of Toronto, his name's Seek Knowledge, a queer person of color, he's Seek, and so he's bringing these like really syncopated like Indian meets Caribbean beats into it, so it's gonna be a great mixtape.
Okay.
And it's gonna have remixes of Promise Me from Mother. It's going to have Migrant and Orcas on it. So, yeah.
Cool. Okay. Nice. So, you see, like, you have an agenda full of, like, events and releases coming up.
I got music to share, and it's been just great. I'm really grateful that cool. It's coming through.
It's nice to hear, no, because, yeah. You know, the... And also, you know, for you, Varros, you know, because just you are about to release the first EP, you know, like debut.
Yeah.
But also you see that like probably what can be like a nice like icebreaker, no? And then you can get more confident and like work on like songs less, no? Maybe or like, you know, my point is like I'm trying to say that probably you can like you know, like release more music, no? Like and find out a way to. It's once you figure out your like signature sound, your like who you are, no, like totally. Artistically speaking, it's easier to make music under that umbrella, no?
Yeah, yeah. Actually,
it's a matter of identity. I mean, no.
Yeah, like this project now releasing, it feels so cleansing and it feels amazing. Like, yeah, it is. Yeah. And like, I felt this project, the X Days. I did very much for myself, and I'm actually working on two projects that are kind of happening organically and coinciding with each other. One that's kind of a continuation of the X Days, that's like an older sister almost, and another one that's working titles Boy Parts, which is more experimental and electronically influenced and more of like my experiences here in the city and commenting on like sexuality and gay culture and moving into more of a politically focused lens, especially with how impactful the times are that we live in this country. So
yeah, that's gonna be exciting.
Yeah, I'm very excited.
Cool.
Yeah.
So many things are like cooking,
brewing.
Yeah. Like slowly, yes.
Yeah.
But you know, it's like creative work, again, like I said, I feel really grateful that it's still flowing through me, but we don't know what tomorrow holds. And maybe there is a time that my body or my senses need to take a break and take, you know, figure out the next new sound that I'm going to have. So it's really quite erratic and unpredictable.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm just going to enjoy today of how it's happening. It's like, I'm really into succulents, like the plants.
The plants, yeah.
Like a massive collection of cacti and also the succulents. And, you know, each one of them are such individuals. They have different flowering patterns. Not just, they're not seasonal. Some can be seasonal, but some just, you know, take years to flower and just flower once and that's it. So it's hard to predict what my flowering is going to be until I've really seen it. So when we talk in 20 years from now, then we'll be having a whole different conversation.
Yeah. Yeah. So the next album is going to be like with the same formula, not with the strings and maybe not.
That's a great question.
Okay.
It's really exciting because a lot of the next record is much more percussive.
Okay.
And a lot of the percussion is coming from metallophones.
Okay.
So each song has like a marimba or a xylophone in there, and it's being used in not just like regular way, classical ways of using these instruments, but also
processed,
chopped up within the beat. Instead of, say, using a snare or using like a tom, we are pitch shifting a marimba, and then we're creating reverbs out of, or pads out of reverbs from a marimba, for example. So it's very percussive, heavy. But I mean, there's still strings. It's almost like strings are blending out a little bit, and more like percussive metallophones are coming. There's gamelan. There are gamelan sounds, the Indonesian metallophone, family of metallophone, phonic instruments. And so that's really exciting too. Oh, another cool instrument that's on the next record is the santur, which is a Persian classical instrument. It's like a zither. And it's sort of the mother of all the zithers that went across or developed and evolved in like Europe and the rest of Asia. So China, of course, you know, has their own form of zithers, but the European, Northern African, Central Asian, East Asian, or Southeast Asian zither really came from this instrument called santur, which came out of Persia. And so I'm playing on the record, there's this incredible artist, his name's Faraz Minui, and he's played with Yo-Yo Ma and the Silk Road Ensemble, and he's on the record, and he's on two of the songs. So like electronics with this like rare Persian classical instrument, sort of like put together like beats. I'm really excited about it, yeah, to share.
Nice. So different identities to each record. So in your process of composition, so you use electronic a lot, no? Electronics a lot. So like you mentioned before, you use like vocals as beat, like part of the beats. So you sample, and so you have like this classical like writing, like scoring for like strings, but also you use technology for composition. So you sample parts, put it together, you know.
Yeah. So, I mean, we were talking about this, the songwriting and the music production process, and kind of carrying that thought along, you know, it starts with the phrase, then it takes three directions. One is the songwriting direction, that's the core foundation. The second piece is the rhythm and the beat. That rhythm and beat is built around the phrase that I imagined that came to me. And that beat work is, I usually just build it on Ableton or Logic, just some demos of it, and then I go into the studio and evolve it and like create funny sounds, like record sounds in the studio, some bizarre, eccentric, esoteric sounds, like plucking of cactus thorns, for example, could be the sound of like a could be pitch shifted into, say, a snare sound or like a closed hi-hat sound. So songwriting, the next part that I work on is the beat work for each given piece, and that gets the basic rhythm going, the basic groove going, and the pocket. And then the third piece is then the melody that gets on top.
And the melody is really taking that phrase and evolving the melody around it. And the melody then spans into, again, bifurcates in two directions. One is the vocal melody, and then there is the instrumental melody. None of my pieces have the chamber instrumental melody as a backup supporting element. It's got its own
voice. Like we talked before, no? Yeah. It's not like doing like following or doing like the third. It's like the kind of two melodies that going like in a separate, but you know, kind of like going to the same direction, no? But it definitely are two separate.
There's a conversation happening. There's a dialogue.
Cool. That's actually bring me to ask about your guys' influences, no?
Yeah.
Because I mean, besides like Björk, you mentioned Björk, and you mentioned like Adele, Sam Smith, or Amy Winehouse. You got something you wanna play for us that is that represent you, that make you follow this path to be an artist, to be a songwriter, performer?
I have a lot to play, but I'm gonna. Okay. I mean, it's all we, over we the got, map.
There is some. We have some time restriction. You know, it's 3:22. We have time till. Just pick one or two.
All right.
Yes, and we play some like one song each. Let's say.
Yeah.
That is influential.
Yeah.
Why don't you start?
Okay.
And I'll go.
I guess right now. So I've been really inspired by the fusion of electronic music meeting soul, and one artist that I discovered a few years ago recently, Banks, that my partner introduced me to. I'm obsessed with her. I love her, and she was the first artist I was exposed to who creates electronic music and has so much soul and rawness within it that to me feels very much like the influences that I mentioned, like Adele or Janis Joplin or a lot of the classic music that I grew up on. And so one song that I brought here is called Stick, and I love the percussiveness, like the work that I'm moving into electronically. I've always been obsessed with, oh, do you have a dongle?
Yeah,
this little thing. I know. I'm like, oh.
Otherwise, we can find it on Spotify.
That'd be awesome.
Yeah.
I should have one. Hold on a second.
Guys, you want to find it, Ash?
Yeah, what's on Spotify?
It's called Stick.
No, I have a dongle. Oh, no worries. Just let me pick it out. Right. Take it out from the. Trying to be.
And by Banks.
Yes. There you go.
There, yeah.
And you're listening to BFF.FM Espresso Sesh. We are live in the Mission District, San Francisco, California.
Woo!
Ash and Varros, special guests today. All right.
Okay.
All right. Try this.
And put your volume all the way up, please.
All right. Get this here. Yeah, I love the minimalism of her, like, it's very, her music's interesting because it's very complex and there's a lot of layers that are happening within each song, but it feels very minimal and very like spacious. And I love percussiveness. In the EP, I kind of experimented a little bit like with Jason Slota, like kind of percussive Motown beats. And I love all of the like qualities in her work that feels very like primal and tribal, but emotive also, and it's really cool. So the song is called Stick.
Quick. I want to dance.
And this was Banks.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah, with some nice pattern, like kind of like it's definitely it's like synth pop, you know, with like it's like synth strings, like openings. Never heard this before. You know, the good thing is that music, so so much music out there.
Yeah,
you know? There's great music out
there.
Yeah, and it's hard to keep up, no? But you know, it's music, so
yeah,
always amaze you. And Ash, what you got?
Okay, as, so I made a whole playlist just for you, Nino, for this show.
Okay.
So, how much time are we talking? We're just gonna do one song, right?
I mean, we can do one. I mean, time is tyrant.
Yes,
you know?
Yes. So. Totally makes sense. I'll just do one song, but I brought this Heaven in Las Vegas by the Cocteau Twins.
Okay, yeah.
Another really liberating band where melody was queen or king for them, and then they wrote the words around the melody, and a lot of their like writing is like funny plant names, you know, and it does make sense, but the melody is just gorgeous. So one of my favorite songs that I've been listening to, I mean, on this record that I've been listening to a lot is... Cherry Colored Funk. It's a beautiful song, but we won't play that today.
Okay.
The mix that I have for you is I have Bjork, and you tell me which one you want.
So. No, you pick.
Okay.
Yeah, you pick.
So I got Tchaikovsky because I think he's erratic and weird, and you know, he was in the closet for the longest time, and like I believe he killed himself. He died due to some unfortunate circumstances, but incredible composer. Then I have, of course, Bjork. I have Yoga from Bjork and Bachelorette, which I think is an incredible song. Antony and the Johnsons, who's now Anoni, another incredible artist, beautiful
who
voice.
Is now, I know Antony and Johnson, it goes by Anoni.
So Antony and the Johnsons was the band, and then Anoni, he got a gender change, and now Anoni is a she.
Oh, okay. Wow.
Yeah. And, but I don't know what pronoun they prefer, so we're just going to call them they.
They, okay, yeah.
And, the most recent record called Hopelessness is just this beautiful record about sadness, but it's done so poetically and beautifully, and the construction is so avant-garde. You like it? It's like all electronic.
Yeah, actually, yeah. I thought like first time I heard your music, Varros, I was associating to Antonino Musco, you know, for like the vocals especially, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, so yeah, cool.
Yeah,
you brought it up.
Yeah, I mean, you do sound like Anoni a lot. So what was I going to say? And I mean, incredibly, Anoni is that kind of an artist. Like, his music videos have a pregnant Natalie Portman underwater, or have like a Naomi Campbell in the video. Like, how does one do that? It's sort of inspiring to create that sort of art at that scale. So another artist I really respect. Then I got Missy Elliott, who she puts stuff out and it's so bold and so fresh all the time. It's like constant great product. MIA, have to have her in there. Joni Mitchell, you already played California. And then this really old band, it's almost like pre-Motown, Motown-ish, The Ravens. And they have beautiful voice and this great choir. I think it's an all African-American band. And then Benjamin Clementine, he's a contemporary, and he was discovered in France, I think in like singing in the subway in Paris. And then he was discovered and picked up by I don't know what record label, but his voice is beautiful. He's collaborated with who are those guys? I'm spacing their name. The Damon Albarn, what's his band called? The Gorillaz. Yeah, so he collaborated with the Gorillaz, and so he's great. But I'm gonna play Missy Elliott because I think she is badass.
All right. Yes.
She is badass. So.
Pull the volume all the way up, please.
All right. All right. Get your freak on.
Oh, I love this song.
Yeah.
Hit me. Hit me. Hit me. Hit me. Hit me. Yeah. Hit me. Yeah. Give me some news. Yeah. Give me some news. Yeah. Give me some news. Missy be putting it down. I'm the hottest round. I told y'all mother. Y'all can't stop me now. Listen to me now. I'm lasting 20 rounds. And if you want me, then come on get me now.
Yes.
Is you with me now?
Yes.
Then biggie, biggie bounce.
Yes.
I know you dig the way I switch my style.
Holla, holla.
People sing around.
Yes.
The
people jump around. You know, yes. Me and Timberland been high since 20 years ago. Yes. What the dealio? Now what the drillio? Yes. If you wanna battle me, then people, let me know. Yes. Hello. Got the feeling, son. Let me throw you some. Yes. People, here I come. Yes. Now sweat me when I'm done. Yes. We got the radio shook like we got a gun.
I forgot there was also some tabla action here. Yes.
Timbaland wasn't fucking around. Like, he was just going for the samples. Like, yeah. That's amazing. Yeah.
You know, they're like, so the name you mentioned before, like on your influence, mm-hmm. made me think that, you know, these days we have access to lots of music. No, it's not like back in the day that where you had to order. I mean, I remember growing up, like I was reading about reading like
it's like previously the record labels would control the distribution and who gets to hear what, and they still do to a great degree, but I think Spotify has redemocratized, like, any artist who's got like inspiration and idea and some talent can actually record and get music out there. So it's made mm-hmm. things really incredibly easy for an artist to get your music out there. And to the listener to experience, like you said, this universe. But, you know, there's the flip side to it too. Like Spotify, you know, as artists, each stream is like $0.005. And in a good month, I'd make, say, you know, like 4,000 downloads on iTunes would be like about $4,000. Not bad. But with iTunes, times 0.005. So like, I have to work so much more harder to to make ends meet and make it sustainable.
Mm-hmm.
But again, therein is, you know, they're both two sides to the story, because Spotify has indeed helped with discovery. And I do think playlists are like the new curated like radio stations in a way, you know, so it's really interesting.
Yeah, you know, as an artist, you're never going to make the money as a Spotify engineer will make, no? Like, so somebody actually brought this topic like back in the like few episodes ago, mm-hmm. no? I don't know how many millions plays you need to get half of the monthly wage, you know, somebody working for Spotify. But, you know, this is another topic.
Yeah, totally another topic.
You know, like, it's unfortunately, you know, people take for granted music, so, and artistry, so they don't pay for it. So like even when there is a cover charge to a show, like, oh, it's a cover charge.
Yeah.
You know, it's another topic, you know.
But, you know, I mean, all I'm trying to call out is it's every story's got two sides to it. And, you know, this is reality. Like, Spotify has made life easier for the listener. And I'm a listener, too. I'm an artist, but I'm a listener, too. And it's made my life much easier. I can find an entire universe catalog on Spotify. So it's where the future is. And as an artist and as a listener, we together need to figure out what the future looks like mm-hmm. for this music to continue being produced. And I think that's just the reality of it. It's not a bad thing or a good thing. It's just what it is.
Just what it is. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And, you know, nowadays you cannot, like, skip it. Like, you have to be on Spotify, you know, like, so...
Yeah.
Just deal with it. Yeah. And, but, you know, as a listener, like, take advantage of the wide range of, like, choices that are there.
Yeah.
You know, before the video was blocked because of the copyright. because we played for Missy Elliott. Yeah, you know.
She's
so,
badass.
Yeah, she is badass. You know, so, I mean, these things happen.
Yeah.
Yeah. But, you know, I don't want to stop you guys playing for, like, some... or we can keep going on influence, or we can play some other original song. What do you guys think? Let's play an original song, maybe?
Sure.
Yeah. Joy and Sorrow?
Yeah, Joy and Sorrow is a gorgeous little song. We can play Joy and Sorrow. Yeah, let's play that. Let's
play that. Yeah. You want to briefly introduce it?
Okay, so Joy and Sorrow is also sort of one of the anchor songs of this record. It's really about... It's actually... Okay, so the original writing of Joy and Sorrow is not by me. It's by Khalid Gibran, who is one of the most published poets in all history.
Gibran.
And so it's his poem, and he likens, like, joy, he basically is saying joy and sorrow are basically the same thing. It's just the flip side of the story is, you know, in your bed sleeping next to you is sleeping joy. When you're feeling sad in your bed, to just turn around and sleeping right next to you is joy. I mean, these things are so, it's basically the other side of the same coin
mm-hmm.
is joy and sorrow. And the reason I was so gravitated towards that poem and why I turned that into a song is because my mother really helped shape my understanding of what joy and sorrow meant. And I haven't experienced joy ever without understanding what sorrow is. And I haven't experienced sorrow without understanding what joy is. And that contrast really helps me be really aware of my feelings. And in fact, it helps me write my material because it makes me aware of how I'm feeling. So yeah, that's why the song is on there. And it's a beautiful song.
Let's listen to it. Ash, Joy and Sorrow of the album Mother.
Your joy is your sorrow. Laughter rises filled with tears. How else can it be? Deeper sorrow carves into me. More joy you can contain. Thank you.
And that was Joy and Sorrow, Ash, of the album, freshly released, Mother, that you can actually check it out and buy it online. Besides all the music stores, I would recommend Bandcamp, because, yes. You know, it's...
Bandcamp pays artists.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Bandcamp is awesome.
And his website, actually, ash.space. There's an I in the...
There's an I. A-I-S-H dot space.
Dot space. Yeah. And from there you can watch his videos, amazing videos. We talk about that at the beginning. And check out the music and download, get copies, the digital copies. And
by the way, there's merchandise coming on the tour. You're going to get physical vinyl.
Okay.
So if you want to get physical vinyl, awesome, then just wait a couple of weeks. It's coming. Or you can actually pre-order starting in 2 weeks from now.
Okay, cool. Yeah. So yeah, some physical goods are coming as well.
Yeah.
Okay. But, you know, like, let's, before the, you say the tour, no? But this tour starts and ends in San Francisco. The first date is going to be Saturday, the 28th, yep, July 28th, at the Lost Church.
Yes.
And Varros is going to open the show for you, no?
Yes.
So, you know, going to get two so in one, you know, like, so Saturday the 28th at the Lost Church.
Yes, thank you, yep.
Okay, Ash, you wanna read a poem, no? That was to you stumble upon. You were saying before.
Yeah, you. So when we were talking, you like bring something that spoke to you that you could maybe sing or share with the listeners. So I picked this poem called "The Blue Dress," and the reason why I picked it is because when I just accidentally stumbled upon this poem, I love poetry, so I go and poets.org all the time, and it was like one of the featured poems or something. Anyway, and when I read the poem, I was like, this is literally metaphorically what I'm trying to say through my record. And it was just incredible to see that there could be another person out there who actually has a similar relationship with their mother and that they're trying to work through with art in that same way. And it turns out that it was written by this great individual, Saeed Jones, and I believe he lives in New York, and he runs the morning show on BuzzFeed with Isaac Fitzgerald, and I think it's called AMFM, I think. But anyway, it's a morning BuzzFeed show where they live stream it on Twitter, etc. It's a really popular show. I had no idea. Again, I discovered that show via this poem. So I'm going to read that poem.
Please.
The Blue Dress by Saeed Jones. Her blue dress is a silk train, is a river, is water seeps into the cobblestone streets of my sleep, is still raining, is monsoon brocade, is winter stars stitched into puddles, is goodbye in a flooded antique room, is goodbye in a room of crystal bowls and crystal cups, is a ring-ting ring of water dripping from the mouths of crystal bowls and crystal cups, is the Mississippi River in the hallway, is leaks like tears from windowsills of a drowned house, is windows open to waterfalls, is a bed, is a small boat, is a ship, is a current come to carry me in its arms through the streets, is me floating in a dress through those streets, is only the moon sees me floating through those streets, is me in a blue dress out to sea, is my mother, is a moon out to sea. So that's a poem. It's very touching.
There was, yes. And also, you know, like we send a message like in a bubble when we express ourselves like in songs, like composition. Mm-hmm. And you never know who's gonna pick up the bubble, no? And share like the same feeling you had while you wrote that, no? Yeah. So, you know, this is the case, like
it's like with, okay, you might think it's woo-woo, but there is a spiritual communication that happens amongst all of us, like as humanity. Sure, we're like physically talking to each other, but at a spiritual level, I think we're all communicating with each other. So yeah,
and the ideas, yes, in the ideas world, like, yes. It's about time to wrap this show up. I want to thank you guys so much, Ash and Varros. Check them out, ash.space. and varrosmusic.com. Thank you guys for being here. Check them out live in San Francisco at the Lost Church this Saturday. Saturday 28th, July 28th, is going to happen soon. Stay tuned on BFF.fm because Astral Projection Radio Hour is coming in the house. And I would like to close the show with another song from Mother. You pick it.
Great. Let's play. Ooh, it's so hard to pick. Let's play Promise Me. That song is in the voice of my mother. So that, I think, would be a good bookend. And Nino, thank you so much for having us on the show.
Thank you so much, Nino. All
right. Thank you guys so much for being here. So, Promise Me, closing song from Mother by Ash. Thank you so much for listening. See you next week. Same time, same station. BFF.fm. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.